Assalamu alaikum.
Welcome to the first part of gram-negative bacteria. In this video, we'll take a look at some of the important gram-negative bacilli. The first one, we're going to call him Pseudomonas aeruginosa. He's an obligate aerobe, and a cool mnemonic to remember this is aeruginosa is aerobic. He's also non-lactose fermenting, but is positive for oxidase, and this is particularly important for lab interpretation, and we'll discuss this more in the second part of this topic. And on culture, he has the scent of grapes. Moreover, the culture would look blue to greenish, and this is because he produces a blue-green color from the pigments pyoverdin and pyocyanin. When it comes to his virulence factors, he has some mighty weapons such as phospholipase C, which damages cell membranes, endotoxin, which is common between all gram-negatives, and if you remember from our first video, the introduction to microbiology, we mentioned that this is what causes the fever and shock in patients with gram-negative infections. And then he has exotoxin A, which inhibits EF2, or elongation factor 2, by adding an ADP ribose moiety to it, and thus not allowing the cell to make proper elongated proteins. For the clinical importance, a high yield point is that it can cause nosocomial infections, but that's not all. In fact, he can cause otitis externa, which is inflammation of the external ear, pneumonia, which is inflammation of the lung, osteomyelitis, or inflammation of the bones, and many other infections. The point here is that he affects many parts of the body, and can even cause something called rapidly progressive necrotic cutaneous lesions, known as ecthyma gangrenosum, which is typically only really seen in immunocompromised individuals. And that's pretty much all you have to know about Pseudomonas, so let's move on. The second gram-negative bacteria that we will discuss is E. coli. It's one of the most high-yield bacteria that you need to know about, so let's begin with its distinguishing features. E. coli is a gram-negative rod, facultative anaerobe, and he is part of our normal GI microbiota. And unlike Pseudomonas, he's oxidase negative. He's the only lactose fermenter out of all the bacteria we're going to discuss in this video, and please keep this in mind when we get to the lab diagnosis part in the second video. To culture E. coli, we can use McConkie's agar and eosin methylene blue agar. On McConkie's agar, lactose fermenters will grow in pink colonies, where lactose non-fermenters will grow in colorless colonies. So, E. coli will grow in pink colonies. On eosin methylene blue agar, it produces a metallic green sheen. Now let's discuss its virulence factors. First of all, he is catalase positive, so patients with chronic granulomatous disease, or CGD, are at increased risk of getting this infection. And to explain why that happens, we need to know that the neutrophils and macrophages use reactive oxygen species, or ROS, to kill the bacteria. And people with CGD have a defect in the enzyme NADPH oxidase, which is important to generate the ROS. However, if a bacteria invades a patient with CGD, the patient can borrow hydrogen peroxide from the bacteria and use it to generate ROS and kill the bacteria. But if the bacteria has the catalase enzyme, then this borrowing mechanism will not work, since catalase enzyme will break down any hydrogen peroxide in the bacteria, which will make the patient susceptible to catalase positive bacteria. E. coli is also encapsulated, meaning it has a capsule, and it also has flagella and pili for movement and adherence. Lastly, he has endotoxin, since he's a gram-negative bacteria. And also, E. coli is very genetically diverse and can be differentiated into serotypes based on differences between three antigens. The first antigen is O antigen, which is related to the lipopolysaccharide. And remember from our introduction to microbiology that all gram-negative bacteria has lipopolysaccharide in their outer membrane. Then it has H antigen, which is associated with the flagella, and K antigen, which is associated with the capsule. The first clinical importance here is gastroenteritis, and we have two main types of E. coli that are particularly important here. The first one is enterotoxigenic E. coli, which affects the small intestine and causes watery diarrhea. And then we have enterohemorrhagic, which affects the large intestine and causes bloody diarrhea. Let's begin with enterotoxigenic E. coli, or ETEC for short. It's transmitted via water and is associated with traveler's diarrhea. And it's called so because of the classical clinical presentation, which is traveling to Mexico, where the patient drinks the contaminated water. Traveler's diarrhea is also known as Montezuma's revenge. Fun fact, Montezuma was an Aztec emperor back in the 16th century who used to rule Mexico. ETEC produces heat labile toxin and heat stable toxin. The heat labile toxin, which is similar to color toxin, increases cyclic AMP, whereas the heat stable toxin increases cyclic GMP. Now let's discuss enterohemorrhagic E. coli, or EHEC. EHEC is most commonly transmitted by eating undercooked meat, such as undercooked hamburger. You can remember that from the etch in its name. EHEC toxin is Shigellic toxin that inhibits the 60S subunit of the ribosome. And lastly, remember that EHEC can cause HUS, or hemolytic uremic syndrome. Other than gastroenteritis, E. coli can cause other diseases including UTI, urinary tract infection. Actually, E. coli is the most common cause of UTI, and it uses the pili to adhere to the urothelial surface. It's more common in females because they have a shorter urethra, and E. coli can also cause neonatal meningitis, and this is because of the capsule it has. So remember that the K antigen is associated with the capsule. So mostly, the serotypes that contain K antigen are the cause of meningitis. Lastly, E. coli is the leading cause of gram-negative sepsis because of the endotoxin it has. This is all you need to know about E. coli. And this concludes our video, but stay tuned for the next part.